Welcome to church, everybody. Let's stand together. We serve a God and worship God who is true to his promise. He's faithful. So we worship him today. So come on, let's put our hands together. Let's celebrate that today. Here we go.
Is a lamp unto my feet. Your way is the only way for me. It's a narrow road that leads to life, but I want to be on it. It's a narrow road, but the mercy's wide, cause you're good on your palm.
Come on, we sing this out together.
Oh, I'll take you at your word. He said it, I believe it. I've seen how good it worked. If you started, you're completed. I'll take you at your word. You spoke in the cave. Fell in.
That's right.
Oh, I know, cause I've seen it in my life. It's a narrow road that leads to life, but I wanna be on it.
Oh, it's the narrow road, the tide is high, but you're part of the
Welcome, welcome, welcome to Harvest. We get to take him at his word and we get to worship the Lord today. What a great day to be in the house of the Lord. My name is John. I serve as one of the pastors here over campuses and ministries, and I just wanted to welcome you, especially if this is your first time to the church. Welcome. I'd love to have an opportunity to meet you. I'm going to be hanging out in the lobby afterward, and if there's any way I can serve you or help you get connected, I would love to do that. And for the rest of us that have been here for a bit, we kind of know the drill, right? We get out our phones, we scan either the QR code, or we go to the Church Center app and we check in. And why do we do that every week? You know, there might be something that the Lord is stirring in your heart that you just want to have someone pray for you, and our staff would really be delighted to pray for you throughout the week. And so there's an opportunity for you to fill in that connect card and let us know how we can be praying for you. Well, fall, it's here, it's today, it's new. And fall is a great season because it's kind of like, it's not just that it's new, it gives us an opportunity to kind of align our schedules and to think about what's next for what we're gonna be doing this season. And so many of you have jumped into a community group or you've jumped into a D group because you want to be with other believers. But can I pause for a moment and just ask those of you where Harvest is your home to consider this. How has God gifted you? How has God equipped you with some gifts that you might be able to use to serve him for his glory, but for the benefit of us as the church growing together? There's so many ways to use our gifts. If you have the gift of hospitality, you could be in the parking lot today in the rain. It's beautiful. And you could greet people as they come in or at the door, or you could be an usher. You could be on production, or maybe you could be on the worship team. We're always looking for people to serve in Harvest Kids or Harvest Students. You could be a part of In His Image or the Hope Center. The list is endless. But just why don't you pause for a moment and think about what is it that God has gifted me with that I might be able to glorify him for the good of the church. I would encourage you to find a way to engage in that this fall. You can find out more at harvestbible.org or you can find it on the app. We would just love for you to jump in and to roll up your sleeves and serve the Lord together. When we think about this series that we've just started, it's a whole series on prayer. It's called Ask, and it came out of Matthew 7:7. It says, ask and seek and knock. And I hope this has been an encouragement to you to really, how do I turn up the dial a little bit more in seeking the Lord and asking the Lord and knocking on his heart to hear what it is that he has for us. And I'll tell you, I've done something because I need little reminders. I've set my alarm clock every morning at 7:07 to go off that I might just pause for a moment and just pray. And I'd invite you to join me with that. As a church, 7:07 a.m., if we would all just pause and go before the Lord and ask, seek, and knock, that would be incredible. I'd like for us to pray here in just a second for another church that's meeting like us today. It's Wheaton Bible Church, and Pastor Hannibal Rodriguez is gonna be opening God's word and bringing it. And so would you join me in praying for Wheaton Bible and for our service as we move forward? You are such a good God. You're faithful and true. You're loving, you're kind, and we today just wanna worship you. We come before you and we just want to adore you and lift high your name. And so would you meet us right now? And would you be with Pastor Rodriguez as he opens up your word today? Would you use him in a powerful way that your gospel might go forth? And thank you for our time that we're here to gather. Would you meet us? And it's in Jesus' name we pray, amen. God's word is beautiful. And it's beautiful not just in our language, but in so many different languages. We're gonna be looking at Psalm 96, and I'd like to direct your attention to the screen.
Oh, sing to the Lord a new song. Sing to the Lord all the earth.
Oh, naciones del mundo, reconozcan al Señor. Reconozcan que el Señor es fuerte y glorioso. Las domnului slava cuvenita numele lui. Puceți daruri de mâncare și intrați în curte.
sila Louie.
Sambahin ninyo ang Panginoon sa kagandahan ng kabanalan. Manginig kayo sa harap niya buong lupa.
Say among the nations, the Lord reigns.
El Señor reina.
Rajarigam panigirar.
Yoakkeso tongchiasini.
Il Signore regna.
Domnul emparatseste.
Amen. All the earth is filled with His glory. And we get to sing to Him today. Every nation, tribe, and tongue declares His glory together. So let's put our hands together like this. We sing this out together. We are.
We are a sea of voices. We are an ocean of Your praise. Gathered under one name. We are a tide that's rising, and we cannot be contained. Gathered under one name. Oh.
Oh, Lord, you alone are holy. Your name alone is matchless. Your name is above every other name. God, we sing your praises this morning because of who you are, because of all that you've done. Lord, we thank you for the cross. We thank you for the salvation that we have through Jesus Christ, that is all we need. We have everything in you for that fact alone, that you are all we need, Lord. Thank you for the life that we have in you. Thank you for the privilege that it is to worship you, Lord. Would you receive our worship this morning? As we join with heaven's song, as we join with what is already going on in the throne room, that you are holy, 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 the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come. God, we declare that truth today, and we are in awe of your holiness, Lord. So we praise you this morning. We thank you. We give you the honor that you're due, and we acknowledge that it's you alone that is worthy of all of this. Lord, we love you. We're so thankful. We're so, so, so thankful. It's by your Son's precious, holy, mighty, matchless name. It's by the name of Jesus that we lift up all these prayers, all these songs. It's in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. It's good to worship together. Amen. Well, before you guys have a seat, why don't you turn around, greet someone next to you, let them know you're happy to see them this morning.
See you. How are you? Good? Yeah, it's great to have you. My name is Jeff. I get the pleasure of teaching the Bible here, which is what we're going to do in the next minute or so. Before we do that, though, one of the ways that we worship God is through our giving. The Lord's given us everything that we have, and so it's not actually ours. He's given us to steward it for a period of time, and so part of our worship is that we want to give back to Him a portion of what it is that He's given to us. So we have lots of different ways you can do that here at Harvest. There are little blue boxes in the back if you like to give cash or a check. And if you like newfangled stuff, you can go with a QR code. You can also just get all the information online about all of that. If you are new here, I want to let you know that your presence here is gift enough. It's awesome to have you. I mean, if you're dying, if you just inherited $10 million and you're like, I don't know what to do with it, okay, you can go to the blue box, I guess. But it's great to have you. Thanks so much for being here. This is part of the kind of thing that we do as regular people who come to Harvest. So we're going to keep encouraging you to do that. We want to ask the Lord's blessing on the offering. And we also want to ask God's blessing on our time together as we study God's word. So if you pray with me, it'd be great. Father, I'm thankful for your kindness to us. I'm thankful for the riches that you have granted us. We are, by all accounts, the richest people who have ever lived, and the comforts that we have been given by you are delightful. We're reminded, just as we've had so much sunshine and beauty around us in the last several weeks in particular, we are just super thankful, Father. We've been able to ride bikes and play golf and go for walks and hike and spend time with our friends and family outside eating hamburgers and other stuff. And we just want to thank you, Lord. We don't usually stop and give praise to you for our surroundings as much as we ought, but Lord, it does not go by without us recognizing all that you've given to us. So I pray you find us faithful as we give back to you. It is not a duty that we have. It's a true delight. It's an expression of thanksgiving to you. We know, Father, that many of us have different financial circumstances around, and we actually want to thank you for that, too. Some of us are awash with extra, and some of us are just on the edge and wondering how we're going to be able to pay some stuff in the next little while. Lord, I pray that your church would serve as a community of faith like that they did in the early church, Father, where people didn't view any of their stuff as their own, but instead generously gave to one another wherever someone had need. And so, Lord, I pray that you would find us as a generous people, not just in our money, but our time and our grace and our effort and all the things, Lord, that you've given us. I pray that they would overflow and that we would eventually, we'd become conduits of your grace, Father, to all around us, whoever you put in our way each day. Lord, you know my heart. I desperately want these dear brothers and sisters to know the Lord's Prayer better and for us to pray more. I pray that for myself in particular. I pray, Lord, that we would, you'd move our hearts to pray more, that we'd be the first port of call when we are troubled or worried or facing difficult circumstances, that perhaps a conversation with you would be something that we do every day, all day long in the quiet moments as we're trying to figure out what the next way forward is in some business decisions, or whether or not we're on our way to maybe another meeting, Father, that as we're walking down the hallway, that a conversation with you would be one that is regularly had, and that every one of our anxieties and cares would be cast upon you. You care for us, you say, and you welcome those things. So I pray that you'd find us as a prayerful people, and that through this series that we've gone through, Lord, or we're going through, would you raise the temperature of prayer in our church, that no matter what else could be said about Harvest Bible Chapel, it would be said that they pray. And I pray, Lord, that you would bless our time as we study your word, open people's eyes and ears to it, Lord. I pray that you would soften hearts and spirit. Would you come now and would you use the word that you inspired? Would you help me to speak it faithfully? And would you carry all those words and implant them in the hearts of your people, that we might not just be hearers of it, but doers of it? So we praise you for this now in Jesus' name, amen. I grew up going to church. It was not something I ever really wanted to do. Some of you in the room know exactly what I felt like when I was a kid, because you're kind of kids, or maybe you're an adult and you were like, oh no, church. That was the thing that I did when I was young. I remember having to wear the wrong clothes. I had to wear a certain, you know, I was used to wearing pants that were comfortable, but church was the uncomfortable pants day. Every Sunday, I remember going to different kinds of church. My family was not really involved in any one particular church for a long period of time. A couple places that we ended up going more regularly and got involved at some points. But for the most part, we would go, we would leave, and we'd go watch football or whatever in the afternoons. I do remember certain things about churches, though. I remember my sister and I hated the sermon, which some of you might feel right now. I remember we didn't like it at all because it was always too long and it was always boring. We didn't know any of the words, but so we played tic-tac-toe the entire time. We'd sit next to each other and write down. That was before, of course, the days of cell phone when you can play Bejeweled now, but I learned there that tic-tac-toe is a useless game that you never could win. So I remember my dad singing really low, not because he wanted to, but because the songs would always kind of change octave and they'd be really high, and then all of a sudden, he'd have to go down to the next octave, and my sister and I used to giggle our heads off at every time he would do that, and he'd say, stop it, the Lord's watching. My wife, she went to church. She grew up as a pastor's kid. And so when she went to church, she has three sisters. So it was her and her three sisters with her mom sitting in the front row. And her dad would stop the sermon if they were misbehaving. And he would tell them to knock it off. So be careful today, because I might point you out. I remember church was where I learned that what coffee does to people's breath. After the service, the older people in particular who hadn't eaten much that day, they'd show up to you and they'd always get a little close and you'd be like, oh man, something's gotta happen. Somebody needs a tic-tac. I also remember there's certain things we did in church. I know a lot of people who grew up in like Roman Catholic churches, they know that the kneel and stand and kneel and stand. I remember visiting friends who went to Roman Catholic church, and we go, and I never knew when to stand and never knew when to kneel, and they had little phrases and things they said, and I'd be kneeling when they'd be standing, and then finally I'd stand up, and I was the only one standing, and then I'd sit down. It's very awkward. You just don't know the rules of these things. But one thing I did know is the prayer that was prayed every weekend in the church churches that I attended. It was called the Lord's Prayer, and of course I learned it like I learned the Pledge of Allegiance. Because it was just the thing we did. And when I learned it, I didn't know at the time, but it was the King James Version. But it sounded churchier because it has some these and thous. And so I can say it just like I can say the Pledge of Allegiance. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. And every week it was always the amen. I was like, always loved the amen at the end, right? But like I said, it was kind of like the Pledge of Allegiance to me. I didn't know what it meant. I didn't have any idea as to the importance of it. I just knew it was a thing that we said. A thing we said in church, and it took me until I got to seminary, actually training to teach the Bible, when I really kind of dove into the meaning of the prayer, and I realized a few things. Number one, that really flowery long ending is not in some of the earliest manuscripts. So it was likely added by some scribes later on, because the prayer itself ends with the word evil, and that seems a little bit awkward, especially if it's something we're going to say in church all the time. Delivers from evil. It kind of feels like it needs to have an ending. So they included this long ending in some of the later manuscripts. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. You know, it's kind of flowery. So it's not originally there, which is why in your Bible, many of your Bibles, it won't be included. But you might have a little note that says that there are some manuscripts later on that ended up having some of that information. I remember learning that it's not so much a mantra as it is a model for prayer. You know what I mean by a mantra? Like God's in heaven waiting for you to say this prayer, and if you do and you get all the words right, he's going to give you the good stuff. I think there are a lot of sports teams, as I shared last week, who probably view it that way. If we say this prayer, we're going to win, so don't mess it up. It's not an abracadabra. Instead, it's a series of phrases that are supposed to control the kinds of things that we pray for. Jesus begins it by saying, pray then like this, in this manner. And the first three phrases, our Father in heaven, hallowed be thy name, your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Those first three are very God-focused. They're very much about who God is. You're supposed to begin, in other words, praying to the Lord with a focus on the Lord and who he is, because you need to know who it is that you're praying to before you pray about the stuff. And it's only in the second half that you get to stuff that has to do, quite honestly, with us personally, like the stuff that we normally pray for right at the beginning. By the way, that's not to say that you can't pray for stuff just, you know, you're walking down the hall, oh, Lord, I need help in this kinds of thing. It's not what it's saying. But if you want to have a properly understood prayer life, you need to actually be thinking a lot about who God is. Because when we come to prayer, most of the time, we assume God is not who he is. And if you understand him to be the God who is sovereign over all things and yet he cares for you, you realize that he's a God who you can ask and can do what you're asking and is inclined to do it because he loves you, Father in heaven. So last week we got into those first three phrases. And this week I want to finish talking about the prayer. And again, we call it the Lord's Prayer. It's probably better called the Disciples' Prayer, because the Lord, it's not something Jesus is saying, well, here's how I'm going to pray. He's saying, here's how you ought to pray. So look, here's what we're going to do in the next few minutes. I want to know or try to answer the question, how does Jesus teach us to pray in the last part of the disciples' prayer? What are the things that he tells us to pray about? I got three of them. Just listen, there are three phrases. Here's the first. Jesus teaches us to pray for God's daily provision for what we need. The operative word being daily. He teaches us to pray for God's daily provision for what we need. And you find this in Matthew 6, verse 12. Give us this day, he says, our daily bread. You notice he says it twice. Give us this day our daily bread. Now, I have a question for you. If you've gone to church in your life and you learned some of the church stories, and you've maybe looked at the Old Testament and you know kind of some of the stories of the people of Israel, when I say the phrase daily bread, to what does your mind wander? What story does your mind wander? And the answer to that is, well, that sounds an awful lot like God giving the people of Israel daily bread, literally daily bread as manna in the wilderness. If you were a little Jewish boy or a little Jewish girl, and you were sitting near Jesus when he's giving this Sermon on the Mount, which is what the passage is from, that we're studying, or in the prayers from, we're studying, and he said, daily bread, you'd be like, oh, I know what you're talking about. Or the bread for this day. However it is that he phrased it, you'd be like, oh, manna. So here's what happened. The people of Israel had come across the Red Sea. You know, Moses makes it across with the people. Pharaoh, he drowns in the sea along with the people of Egypt. They sing a song on the other side, Moses and the people worshiping the Lord. Great victory. Thank you, God. We will forever serve you and we are never going to complain until we're hungry. And then we're going to have a few words, which is what happens. They get hungry, you get thirsty, and they go to Moses and say, you know, it'd been so much better had we been back in Egypt where we ate all the time. I know we were slaves and getting whipped every day, but the meat, it was so good. If we need something to eat. Moses goes to the Lord and is like, these people are driving me crazy already. And God says, look, I'm going to take care of them. What I'm going to do is I'm actually going to give you bread every day. You know how the dew falls or the dew rises? I don't know the way that works. I'm not a meteorologist. But the dew comes upon the ground every day. It's going to turn to this thin, wafery bread. And you guys can be fed. And then I'm going to have a whole bunch of quail show up, and you can kill the quail and eat the quail. So that's exactly what happens. Exodus 16, 14, when the dew had gone up, there was on the face of the wilderness a fine flake-like thing, fine as the frost on the ground. And when the people of Israel saw it, they said to one another, what is it? You know what the word manna means? What is it? So all these years they were eating, what is it? Oftentimes when I eat dinner, I say to my wife, what? For they did not know what it was. And Moses said to them, it's the bread that the Lord has given you to eat. This is what the Lord has commanded. Gather of it, each one of you, as much as he can eat. Dude, this is where Golden Corral began, right here. As much as he can eat, you shall take an omer. An omer is a measuring, it's like we have a pint or a quart or a liter. Take an omer, that much, according to the number of the persons that each of you has in his tents. Some people are going to get more, some people are going to have less, depending on the size of their family. And the people of Israel did so, and they gathered some more, some less. But when they measured it with an omer, whoever gathered much had nothing left over, meaning they just the right amount, and whoever gathered little had no lack. Each of them gathered as much as he could eat. And Moses said to them, okay, here's the temptation. You guys are going to be thinking to yourselves, this little manna stuff's pretty good. And sometimes I get hungry at night, and I'm thinking, I need a midnight snack. Or sometimes I get up a little earlier than my friends, and I wake up, and my tummy is grumbling, and I'm thinking to myself, man, the light hasn't come up yet, and so the dew's not on the ground yet, so we don't have new bread for tomorrow. So I want to actually, you know, start having something to eat. So you're going to want to store some away. Because you all, It also might be the case that you're thinking, well, what if God doesn't show up tomorrow? I mean, he said he would, but you know, maybe he won't. So you're going to want to store some of this. So Moses is like, but don't, listen, that's not how this game is played. The Lord is going to provide it every single day. Let no one leave any of it over till morning. But they didn't listen to Moses. Some left part of it till morning, and it bred words and it stank. See, the Lord had set it up in such a way that you have just enough for today. And then you'll go to sleep, and magically, the Lord will provide it tomorrow. And you will have just enough for tomorrow when it's tomorrow. And then you'll go to sleep and he'll provide just enough for tomorrow. So each and every day you will be reminded how much you need to rely upon the Lord. If you start storing it up, you're going to start thinking, oh, I can take care of my life without the Lord. And Jesus tells a story. Luke 12, he tells a story about a rich fool whose problem is that he had extra. And instead of giving away the extra to those in need, he decided, no, the thing I'll do is I'll build bigger barns so that I have plenty to take care of myself for the rest of my life. And then he gives a speech literally to himself. Oh, self, he says. You have been working very hard, oh, self. And now I have all that I need because I have provided it, and I will take care of myself until I have no more breath in my lungs. And Jesus says, this man is a fool. And he's a fool because his wealth has made him think that he can exist without God. And this is the danger. This is the danger of stuff. It can make you think that every eventuality in your life can be taken care of because you have insurance for that. This is why the Lord wants to keep his people with daily bread. It's interesting how that language is picked up in Proverbs chapter 30. This is a fascinating little prayer. It's not a prayer that you and I would pray. This guy named Agur, who's a, you know, he wrote this psalm. This proverb. And here's what he said. He said, two things I ask of you. This is to God. Two things, God, I want to ask of you. Deny them not to me before I die. Number one, remove far from me falsehood and lying. I don't want to be a liar or a fibber in any way. And two, give me neither poverty nor riches. You and I, we pray this one, right? This side, give me neither poverty. And then we... This part is, you know, we give me both, give me riches. Isn't that what we want? Lord, I would like to have that boat. I would like to have that new car. I would like to have enough so that I don't have to worry about money. Wouldn't it be great to be Bill Gates? Wouldn't it be great to be Elon Musk? Wouldn't it be great to never have to worry? You can go to Starbucks and buy whatever you want and never think about it. Never have a budget, never have anything. But you're saying, no, I have a prayer. My prayer is give me neither poverty nor riches, but feed me, and now the ESV does this, this is the version that we're using here, with the food that is needful for me. If you look in the NIV, you'll find that that's translated daily bread. Give me my daily bread. And it's a wink back to the manna. Lord, I want to depend on you like they did in those days, and I'm worried that if I have too much, I won't depend on you, see, lest I be full and deny you and say, who is the Lord? That's the danger of having too much. Is that you end up wondering who the Lord is because, you know, you take care of the things that he's supposed to take care of. It's a danger in having all of these things. And so the Lord has set it up that you and I have daily. Now, listen, I understand. We live in a society where most of the people I'm talking to right now, me included, I have food in my pantry for several days, right? For several days. But the concept of trusting in the Lord for what you need today is what the prayer is about. Bread sort of stands in for everything that you might need to survive today. The Lord wants to provide it to you for today, not for tomorrow, but for today. God never wants us to forget our need for him. We trust him one day at a time. In fact, we're not made to do more. It's a little later in the Sermon on the Mount where Jesus starts talking about this. He gets into it. And he says, therefore, I tell you, don't be anxious about your life. So how are you supposed to live as a person who's following Christ, as a disciple of Jesus? He's like, look, I need you to live daily. Don't be anxious about your life, what you'll eat, what you'll drink, your body, what you'll put on. Is life not more than food and the body more than clothing? Look at the birds, the air. They neither sow nor reap nor gather into barns. And yet your heavenly Father feeds them. Are you not of more value than they are? And which of you, by being anxious, can add a single hour to his span of life? And why are you anxious about clothing? Consider the lilies of the field, how they grow. They neither toil or spin. Yet I tell you, even Solomon in all his glory wasn't arrayed like one of these. But if God so clothes the grass of the field, which today is alive and tomorrow is thrown into the oven, will he not much more clothe you, O you of little faith? Therefore, look, don't be anxious saying, what do we eat, or what do we drink, or what do we wear? For the Gentiles, meaning the people who don't know God, the people who don't understand that they have a heavenly Father who looks after them, they're the ones who are going to be concerned about this sort of thing, because they live in a world without a caring deity. They seek after all these things, but your heavenly Father knows that you need them all. But seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things will be added to you. Therefore, don't be anxious about tomorrow, for tomorrow will be anxious for itself. Sufficient for the day is its own trouble. God's going to take care of you today. Yes, but what about in a week? That's going to come. But today, he's going to take care of you. Have you ever noticed that every night you go to sleep and the whole world keeps operating without you? Look, I know that if we had an evolutionary biologist here right now, they would come up with some comment about, well, the reason that human beings sleep this long is because they evolved into blah, blah. Listen, I'm going to tell you right now that the reason people sleep the way they sleep is because God intended us to have a break between one day and the next, so that he would remind us daily of our limitations. You have to trust the Lord to take care of a whole world when you're asleep. You should trust the Lord to take care of you even when you're awake. He's still in charge, right? So he gives you today, and then he'll give you tomorrow. John Piper, in his great book, A Godward Life, he said it this way. He said, God's mercies are new every morning because each day has enough mercy in it for only that day. This is why we tend to despair when we think that we may have to bear tomorrow's load on today's resources. God wants us to know that we won't. The manna in the wilderness was given one day at a time. There was no storing up. That's the way we must depend on God's mercy. You don't receive today the strength to bear tomorrow's burdens. You're given mercies today for today's trouble. Tomorrow, the mercies will be new, which is what you tell your kids late at night when they're worried about everything because they're tired. You grab them by the little face and you say, no, don't worry. What you need right now is you need sleep. You need to sleep, because what's going to happen is your body's going to rest, your spirit's going to revive, and you'll wake up tomorrow morning and the Lord will have provided what you don't currently have, because that's the way it's set up. I'm not kidding. The reason you and I are so worried most of the time is because we're trying to live tomorrow with today's strength, and it's not meant to be. Live tomorrow with tomorrow's strength. But what if I don't have it? The manna was there every day. The strength will be there every day. In fact, you could pray about it by saying, give us today our daily bread. Second, how should we pray? Well, the next phrase comes right after it. Give us this day our daily bread. And forgive us our debts, as we also have forgiven our debtors. Or pray for daily forgiveness to keep short accounts with the Lord. Pray for daily forgiveness to keep short accounts with the Lord. Forgive us our debts. You know, I had a guy send me an email one time, and he was really angry. Wasn't actually at Harvest. Nobody ever is angry here or sends me emails. And if you believe me, I have a bridge to sell you. So I got this email one time. This guy was very upset because he was saying, you know, one of the things that you do, Jeff, in a lot of the sermons is you tell people that all of life is repentance. That's actually a quote from Martin Luther. It's the first of the 95 theses that he pounded onto the door of the Wittenberg Church to distinguish what he was trying to argue from what the Roman Catholic Church of his day believed. But the first of them was all of life is repentance. Meaning that if the gospel of Jesus Christ is true, that in Jesus we have full forgiveness for our sins, if the gospel of Jesus Christ is true, then every day I should come back to the Lord and receive new forgiveness for all the ways that I have gone wrong. And that repentance is not something to be despised. It's not something to be scared of. It's something to rejoice in. That all of life should be repentance. I'm constantly just coming back to the Lord and coming back to the Lord and coming back to the Lord. In fact, I don't need to go like the prodigal son all the way into the mire eating the pig food. I can just get down the road a little ways and be like, wait, I'm wandering from the Lord, and I come back. And every time I come back, what I will find is a loving heavenly Father who will run to me and lavish his grace on me. Every day. In fact, this is something that I would argue that we need to keep up with regularly because, you know, we ought to keep short accounts. This is how you have a good relationship, is you keep short accounts with your spouse. If you end up letting things grow and grow and grow, the wall that they build up eventually gets too big to deal with. And then you end up in the office of a pastor and they're trying to undo the wall and there's just so much there. And every one of us pastors wants to tell you, just if you had you kept short accounts, this wouldn't be the case. So, all of life is repentance. Anyway, this guy, he wrote me an email. He was really upset. He said, look, I asked the Lord to forgive me when I came to faith in Christ. If I ask him to do it again, it's a sign of unbelief because I don't believe that he forgave me, because Jesus forgave me both my past, present, and future sins at that present moment. In fact, I found out that there's a whole bunch of teachers on TV who've been arguing this, that if you really want to honor God, just say, ask him to forgive you once and then never again. And I, every time, I always think about that old stupid joke about a husband who said to his wife, I told you I loved you when I got married to you, and if I changed my mind, I'll let you know. I was like, well, that's a marriage I want. Absolutely. Right? What a loved woman, you know. No, it's not how relationships work. Anyway, so I respond to the guy, and what I said to him is, look, can we just agree that the Lord's Prayer or the disciples' prayer is a prayer that ought to be prayed daily, right? Give us today our daily bread. So if it's a prayer that you're supposed to pray daily, why then does it say forgive us our debts? Daily. And the reason is because you need all of life is repentance. you need to keep coming back to the Lord. It is a good thing to keep coming back to the Lord and receiving forgiveness from the Lord, because you don't want a wall to build up with God, do you? George Whitefield, who was one of the great preachers in the English language, used to go out in the middle of fields, put a soapbox down, stand up, and preach to like 20,000 people. Every night, this guy, every night, he's a single man, so he had some time. Every night, he would, before he went to bed, he would pray this prayer. Here was his prayer. He said, God, give me one deep humility, a burning love, a well-guided zeal, and a single eye, and then let men and devils do their worst. Now, each one of those phrases was a prompt for him to ask himself a whole bunch of questions. So when he said, give me a deep humility, the questions he would ask himself late at night were, have I looked down on anyone today? Have I been too stung by criticism today? When he said, God, give me a burning love, he would say, have I spoken or thought unkindly of anyone today? Have I been impatient and irritable, a well-guided zeal? Have I avoided people and tasks I know I should face? Have I been anxious and worried, a single eye? Am I doing what I'm doing for the glory of God and the good of others, or for the approval of others and the hunger for acclaim? Am I looking at anyone with envy? Am I giving into even the first motions of lust or gluttony? This guy would actually have the paper, and he'd have these little titles, and he'd write down all the things that happened that day that actually where he walked away from the Lord, so that he couldn't get too far down that garden path away from the Lord, and he would stop every day and say, no, I don't want to run away from you like the prodigal. I want to come back to you. All of life is repentance. Forgive us our debts. Is the wall between you and God grown a bit? It's easy to let it grow a bit. You get angry with the Lord because he didn't do what you wanted him to do. You get frustrated that your life hasn't turned out like you want, or he hasn't answered the prayer that you think you should have. So it builds. It builds in unbelief. It's a sin. You and I, we don't believe the Lord and who he says he is. And so we start having opinions about him that are wrong. And so it grows and grows and grows. And before too long, you still come to church. Of course, you still come to church and you sit there, but inside, when we talk about the goodness of God, you're just not sure. The solution is in the Lord's Prayer, forgive us our debts. And what you will find when you say that is a father who runs to you and lavishes rings and robes and kills fatted calves for you. I do have to add, the thing that's added at the end. You and I, we love this part. Forgive us our debts. Oh, isn't it great that we have a father who's gonna forgive us no matter what it happens and no matter how bad it gets, we can just come back to him? Sometimes this is the part that's a little harder, right? As we also have forgiven our debtors. Isn't it interesting that that's written as an assumption? Yeah, you guys are gonna do this. You're gonna forgive your debtors. You know why he says that? It's because, look, Christian people, genuine Christian people, one of the marks of who they are is that they're forgivers. And the reason they're forgivers is because they've been forgiven. The reason that they're really good at showing grace is because they've received so much grace. Jesus himself even tells a story about this, doesn't he? At one point he says, look, there's this great master, king, whatever, and he has a guy who owes him $5 million, and the master comes to the guy and says, listen, you owe me a lot. Your debt is enormous, but I'm going to forgive your debt. And then the guy says, hugs, and this is fantastic. He walks out the door across the street, sees the guy who owes him $5, and he goes over and grabs him by the throat, and he said, give me my $5. You owe me. The juice is running, buddy. Well, somebody watched it, reports back to the master, the king. The king calls the dude in. And when he does, his master summoned him and said, this is Matthew 18:32. And he said to him, you wicked servant, I forgave you all that debt because you pleaded with me, and you should not have had mercy on your fellow, and should you not have had mercy on your fellow servant as I had mercy on you? And in his anger, his master delivered him to the jailers until he should pay all of his debt. So also, Jesus says, my heavenly Father will do to every one of you if you do not forgive your brother from your heart. In fact, in the Lord's Prayer, at the end of this prayer in Matthew 6:14, in case you and I just ran through the as we forgive our debtors part, he kind of comes back and doubles down and he says, for if you forgive others their trespasses, your heavenly Father will also forgive you. But if you don't forgive others their trespasses, neither will your Father forgive yours. One of the key evidences that you are a genuine Christian is your willingness to pass along the grace you've received. We are not just people who keep short accounts with our Lord. We're people who receive the short accounts others want to keep with us, or the long accounts. And when they come and they ask for forgiveness, we say, if there's anyone who should understand forgiveness, it's me. And if you don't see that spirit, that heart inside of you, I'm just telling you, based on the word of God, it's a little yellow flag waving in your heart saying, maybe you're not what you claim. Maybe the gospel hasn't actually hit you deep enough yet. There's a video of this, went viral, of this little girl. She was an older sister. And her parents had given her some toys. And she was sitting on the floor with the toys, and she's playing with the toys. And her little sister, because her mom had told her, you know, little sister did, hey, can I play with the toys? And she said, go ask your sister to share them, right? So little sister runs in and she says, hey, can I play together with the toys that mom gave you? And big sister says, you need to ask properly. And little sister says, well, how? And the big sister says, you need to say, may I please play with these toys? And little sister says, may I? And her big sister says, please. Little sister says, please. May I please play with these toys? Little sister, okay, may I please play with these toys? And big sister said, no. Now, I gotta tell you, the parent in me is like, oh, no, you did not. You did not, right? I think I've said before that you go to McDonald's, get the fries, you give them the oldest in the back because you don't want to be driving in hand, throwing fries at each kid, you know, one for you, one for you, one for you. So you give them the oldest to spread out. Here, I want you to steward the fries, kid. You put them in the back, and the others are fighting. Hey, Ethan, that's my oldest. He won't share the fries. And I'm like, pull the car over. It's on. I didn't give you the fries so you could hoard them, you little pig. Right? This hasn't happened. I didn't. You get angry about these sorts of things because it drives you absolutely nuts to think that something that you gave to them, the grace that you gave to them, is something they're not willing to give to others. And that's how the Lord feels. The grace he gives, he expects to be passed on. Last one. We're supposed to pray for protection from the enemy and success against his schemes. We're supposed to pray for protection from the enemy and success against his schemes. This is actually a really fascinating end to this passage. And we have to do a little dissection of some of the words here. The last phrase, and lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. So let's deal with this word first. So in the original language, so the New Testament was written in Greek. And so if you go to the Greek here, this word is right here. It's the word the. We say that it's an articular word, meaning it has the article in front of it, the. So there's a difference between saying deliver us from evil and delivering us from the evil. Why does it say the evil? Which is why a lot of translators are like, It's not just evil in general, it's referring to a particular evil. This phrase, the evil, is found actually earlier in the Sermon on the Mount, and when it's found earlier, it refers quite clearly to the evildoers. So it's a person who does evil or who is evil. And this is a singular phrase. So the idea, so this is why if you go to the NIV, if you go to the CSB, the Christian Standard Bible, you go to the New English Translation, if you go to the New Living Translation, all of them have translated this, the evil one. And they're right. They're right. The prayer is deliver us from the evil one. It's also to lead us not into, see that word temptation? It's the same word that you find in other places that is used for test. So which is it? Are we supposed to pray, Lord, don't lead us into test, or don't lead us into temptation? Well, let's ask some questions. Does the Lord tempt us? The answer to that is no. We actually have passages like James 1:13 that say that the Lord doesn't tempt. Let no one say when he is tempted, I am being tempted by God. God cannot be tempted with evil, and he himself tempts no one. But each person is tempted when he is lured and enticed by his own desire. In fact, we would probably argue that the way it works is that Satan and his minions utilize this fallen desire that you and I have, and he uses that to tempt us away. So Eve is in the garden, and Satan tempts, when he's in the serpent, he tempts Eve to deny God, because that's the goal. That's the goal that Satan has. When Satan tempts, the Lord doesn't tempt, Satan tempts. And when he tempts Eve, what he's trying to do is to get him to deny God, to turn away from what the Lord says. So God doesn't tempt, Satan tempts. But what does God do? Well, we have lots of evidence in the Bible that the Lord tests his people. Here's one, Deuteronomy 8, verse 2, and you shall remember the whole way that the Lord your God has led you these 40 years in the wilderness, referring to the people of Israel, that he might humble you. The reason he led you the way he did in the wilderness is so that he might humble you, testing you to know what was in your heart. Well, in what way did he test them in the wilderness? Oh, actually, whether you would keep his commandments or not. And he humbled you and let you hunger and fed you with manna. That whole story of being hungry and being fed with manna was a way for the Lord to test the people to see whether or not they were going to hoard the stuff or not. Which you did not know, this manna you did not know, nor did your fathers know, that he might make you know that man does not live by bread alone, but man lives by every word that comes from the mouth of the Lord. Your clothing didn't wear out on you, and your foot didn't swell these 40 years. Know then in your heart that as a man disciplines his son, the Lord your God disciplines you. Do you see that the Lord actually is like a good father who is seeking to, through a test, to bring about better character in his kids? So the Lord does not tempt, Satan tempts, but the Lord tests through temptation. You follow this? Okay, we're gonna put this together now. You ready? That means that every temptation brought about by the enemy of God and the enemy of your soul to seek your destruction is also a test from your loving Father to bring about your growth. Every temptation from Satan is a test from the Lord. Satan wants to bring about your destruction and your abandonment of God and his ways, and the Lord wants to bring about your growth and the adherence to his ways. Their goals are different, but the test is what the Lord gives. The temptation is what Satan gives. So think about this for a minute, right? So Job, so Satan comes to God and says, hey, this Job guy, well, the Lord says, hey, what do you think of Job? And Satan says, hey, he wouldn't be doing this if you let me at him. And the Lord's like, okay. So Satan goes down, and what does he do to Job? He tempts him by removing a whole bunch of stuff. He tempts him to deny God. But the Lord, who sends Satan, is doing it to test Job, to bring about Job's character. Or you lose your job, God forbid, tomorrow. You lose your job tomorrow, right? And you are now in a situation where you're like, oh, the enemy of my soul has brought about this terrible circumstance in my life. And you'd be right. But it would also be right to say, but the Lord is using this terrible circumstance in my life as a test. God wants to bring about your sanctification. The Satan wants to bring about your destruction. So when we pray, lead us not into temptation, what it's saying is, it's right for us to pray, God, I don't want to do this. I don't want to be in any situation where I'm tempted by Satan or tested by you. Jesus is in the Garden of Gethsemane and he's praying, oh God, would you take this cup from me? I don't want to go through with this. Paul has this thorn in the flesh. He's like, I don't want to have this thorn in the flesh. It's right for us to pray, God, get me out of this stinking mess. I don't want to be tempted, but you will be. Satan is active. But he's still God's devil. He's still under the sovereignty of God. So when you are, we pray the second part and we say, deliver us from the evil one. Lead us not into temptation or testing, but deliver us from the evil one. That when we are, we don't choose the way of Satan. We choose the way of the Lord. We want to follow him. So our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Kingdom come, will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread and forgive us our debts as we also have forgiven our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. Amen. Let me pray. Father, I'm thankful for your kindness to us. And I pray, Lord, that you would bless us with right understanding of what you said in your word regarding this prayer and that it would prompt us to pray more and more and more. You know our hearts, Lord, we tend to hoard things. We tend to want to provide our own security so that we can trust ourselves and not you. I pray that you would move us to trust you. I pray, Father, that you would help us to dismantle any walls that exist between us and you and us and our neighbors. And ultimately, Lord, would you keep us far from the temptation and testing? But when they come, would you help us to honor you in all that we say and all that we do? We pray it for our good, Father, and for your glory in Jesus' name.
Let's stand and respond.
Songs rise to you, but when
temptation comes my way. When I cannot stand, I'll fall on you. And Jesus, you're my hope and stay.
I sing that again.
Teach my song to rise to you. Oh, when temptation comes my way. When I cannot stand, I'll fall on you. In Jesus, you're my hope.
Such a great reminder that we need the Lord every day, and He'll provide the needs that we have. And then there's a truth that's with that, right? That He can be trusted. And maybe you're here today and you're going through a test, you're going through a trial, and you would just love someone to come alongside you and to pray with you. We've got some of our prayer team up here, some of our leaders. We want to be with you during this time to come alongside, that you would be able to sense the presence of the Lord if it feels like it's very far from you. And so take advantage of that. Don't leave today without drawing near to the Lord. He is there and wants to be with you. So as we go out on mission this week, I want you to know this, that you are loved and you are sent on mission, and we get to do that together to represent Jesus Christ, the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. So let's do it with everything we have. Have a great day.